Following is a free-for-download audiobook from the website krishnapath.org. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 5, Part 2, Chapter 16, A Description of Jambudvip. While describing the character of Maharaj Priyavrata and his descendants, Shukadeva Goswami also described Mount Meru and the planetary system known as Bhumandala. Bhumandala is like a lotus flower, and its seven islands are compared to the whorl of that lotus. The place known as Jambudvip is in the middle of that whorl. In Jambudvip, there is a mountain known as Sumeru, which is made of solid gold. The height of this mountain is 84,000 yojanas, of which 16,000 yojanas are below the earth. Its width is estimated to be 32,000 yojanas, and its summit at its summit and 16,000 yojanas at its foot. One yojana equals approximately 8 miles. This king of mountains, Sumeru, is the support of the planet Earth. On the southern side of the land known as Ilavratavarsh, there are mountains known as Himavan, Himakuta, and Nishada, and on the northern side are the mountains Nila, Sveta, and Shringa. Similarly, on the eastern and western side, there are Malyavan and Gandhamadan, two large mountains. Surrounding Sumeru Mountain are four mountains known as Mandara, Meru Mandara, Suparshva, and Kamuda, each 10,000 yojanas long and 10,000 yojanas high. On these four mountains, there are trees 1,100 yojanas high, a mango tree, a rose apple tree, a kadamba tree, and a banyan tree. There are also lakes full of milk, honey, sugarcane juice, and pure water. These lakes can fulfill all desires. There are also gardens named Nandana, Chittarath, Vaibarajaka, and Sarvatobhadra. On the side of the Svaparshva mountain is a kadamba tree with streams of honey flowing from its hollows, and on Kamunda mountain there is a banyan tree named Satavalsha, from whose roots flow rivers containing milk, yogurt, and many other desirable things. Surrounding Sumeru mountain are filaments of the whorl of a lotus. Like filaments of the whorl of a lotus are 20 mountain ranges such as Karanga, Karara, Kushmurba, Vaikantka, and Trikuta. To the east of Sumeru are the mountains Jaratha and Devakuta, and to the west are Pavana and Paryatra, and to the south are Kailash and Karavira, and to the north are Trishringa and Makara. These eight mountains are about 18,000 yojanas long, 2,000 yojanas wide, and 22,000 yojanas high. On the summit of Mount Sumeru is Brahmapuri, the residence of Lord Brahma. Each of its four sides is 10,000 yojanas long. Surrounding Brahmapuri are the cities of King Indra and seven other demigods. These cities are 1/4 of the size of Brahmapuri. Text 1. King Prickett said to Shukadeva Goswami, O Brahmana, you have already informed me that the radius of Bhumandala extends as far as the sun and spreads its light and heat as far as the moon and all the stars can be seen. Purport. In this verse, it is stated that the planetary system known as Bhumandala extends to the limits of the sunshine. According to modern science, sunshine reaches the Earth from a distance of 93 million miles. If we calculate according to modern information, 93 million miles can be considered the radius of Bhumandala. In the Gayatri Mantra, we chant Om Bhur Bhuva Swa. The word Bhur refers to Bhumandala. Tat Sarvatur Varanyam. The sunshine spreads throughout Bhumandala. Therefore, the sun is worshipable. The stars, which are known as nakshatra, are not different suns, as modern astronomers suppose. From Bhagavad Gita 10.21, we understand that the stars are similar to the moon, nakshatranam aham shashi. Like the moon, the stars reflect the sunshine. Apart from our modern distinguished estimations of where the planetary systems are located, we can understand that the sky and its various planets were studied long, long before Srimad Bhagavatam was compiled. Shukadeva Goswami explained the location of the planets, and this indicates that the information was known long, long before Shukadeva Goswami related it to Maharaj Prickett. The location of the various planetary systems was not unknown to the sages who flourished in the Vedic age. Text 2. My dear Lord, the rolling wheels of Maharaj Priyavrata's chariot created seven ditches in which the seven oceans came into existence. Because of these seven oceans, Bhumandala is divided into seven islands. You have given a very general description of their measurement, names, and characteristics. Now I wish to know of them in detail. Kindly fulfill my desire. Text 3. When the mind is fixed upon the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his external feature, made of the material modes of nature, the gross universal form, it is brought to the platform of pure goodness. In that transcendental position, one can understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vasudeva, who is in subtler form, is self-effulgent and beyond the modes of nature. O my Lord, please describe vividly how that form, which covers the entire universe, is perceived. Purport. Maharaj Prickett had already been advised by his spiritual master, Shukadeva Goswami, to think of the universal form of the Lord, and therefore, following the advice of his spiritual master, he continuously thought of that form. The universal form is certainly material, but because everything is an expansion of the energy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, ultimately nothing is material. Therefore, Prickett Maharaj's mind was saturated with spiritual consciousness. Srila Rupa Goswami has stated, Prapanchikataya Buddhya Hari Sambandhi Vastana Mumukshibi Paretyago Vairagyam Falgu Kartite. Everything, even that which is material, is connected with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, everything should be engaged in the service of the Lord. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakura translates this verse as follows. Hari Sevaya Yaha Haya Anukula Vishaya Baliya Tahara Tyaga Haya Bula. Quote, one should not give up anything connected with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, thinking it material or enjoyable for the material senses. End quote. Even the senses, when purified, are spiritual. When Maharaj Prickett was thinking of the universal form of the Lord, his mind was certainly situated on the transcendental platform. Therefore, although he might not have had any reason to be concerned with detailed information of the universe, he was thinking of it in relationship with the Supreme Lord, and therefore such geographical knowledge was not material but transcendental. Elsewhere in the Srimad Bhagavatam 1.5.20, Narada Muni has said, Idam hi Vishvam Bhagavan Ivetara. This entire universe is also the Supreme Personality of Godhead, although it appears different from him. Therefore, although Prickett Maharaj had no need for geographical knowledge of this universe, that knowledge was also spiritual and transcendental because he was thinking of the entire universe as an expansion of the energy of the Lord. In our preaching work also, we deal with so much property and money and so many books bought and sold. But because these dealings all pertain to the Krishna consciousness movement, they should never be considered material. That one is absorbed in thoughts of such management does not mean that he is outside of Krishna consciousness. If one rigidly observes the regulative principles of chanting 16 rounds of the Maha Mantra every day, his dealings with the material world for the sake of spreading the Krishna consciousness movement are not different from the spiritual cultivation of Krishna consciousness. Text 4. The great Rishi Shukadeva Goswami said, My dear King, there is no limit to the expansion of the Supreme Personality of Godhead's material energy. This material world is a transformation of the material qualities, sattva-gun, rajagun, and tamagun, yet no one could possibly explain it perfectly even in a lifetime as long as that of Brahma. No one in the material world is perfect, and an imperfect person could not describe this material universe accurately even after continued speculation. O King, I shall nevertheless try to explain to you the principal regions such as Bhu Goloka, with their names, forms, measurements, and various symptoms. Purport. The material world is only 1/4 of the Supreme Personality of Godhead's creation, but it is unlimited and impossible for anyone to know or describe, even with the qualification of a life as long as that of Brahma, who lives for millions and billions of years. Modern scientists and astronomers try to explain the cosmic situation and the vastness of space, and some of them believe that all the glittering stars are different suns. From Bhagavad Gita, however, we understand that all these stars, nakshatras, are like the moon, in that they reflect the sunshine. They are not independent luminaries. Bhuloka is explained to be that portion of outer space through which the heat and light of the sun extend. Therefore, it is natural to conclude that this universe extends in space as far as we can see and encompasses the glittering stars. Srila Shukadeva Goswami admitted that to give full details of this expansive material universe would be impossible, but nevertheless he wanted to give the king as much knowledge as he had received through the parampara system. We should conclude that if one cannot comprehend the material expansions of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, certainly one cannot estimate the expansiveness of the spiritual world. The Brahma Samhita 5.33 confirms this. Adwaitam achyutam anadimanantarupam adhyam purana purusham navayovanam cha. The limits of the expansions of Govinda, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, cannot be estimated by anyone, even a person as perfect as Brahma, not to speak of tiny scientists whose senses and instruments are all imperfect and who cannot give us information of even this one universe. We should therefore be satisfied with the information obtainable from Vedic sources as spoken by authorities like Shukadeva Goswami. Text 5. The planetary system known as Bhumandala resembles a lotus flower, and its seven islands resemble the whorl of that lotus. The length and breadth of the island known as Jamadweep, which is situated in the middle of the whorl, are 1 million yojanas, 8 million miles. Navadweep, or Jamadweep, is round like the leaf of a lotus flower. Text 6. In Jamadweep, there are 9 divisions of land, each with a length of 9,000 yojanas, 72,000 miles. There are 8 mountains that mark the boundaries of these divisions and separate them nicely. Purport. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakura gives the following quotation from the Vayu Purana, wherein the locations of the various mountains beginning with the Himalayas are described. Text 7. Amidst these divisions, or varshas, is the varsha named Ilavrita, which is situated in the middle of the whorl of the lotus. Within Ilavrita varsh is Sumeru Mountain, which is made of gold. Sumeru Mountain is like the pericarp of the lotus-like Bhumandala planetary system. The mountain's height is the same as the width of Jamadweep, or in other words, 100,000 miles, 800,000 miles. Of that, 16,000 yojanas, 128,000 miles, are within the earth, and therefore the mountain's height above the earth is 84,000 yojanas, 672,000 miles. The mountain's width is 32,000 yojanas, 256,000 miles, and its summit at its summit, and 16,000 yojanas at its base. Text 8. Just north of Ilavrita Varsh and going further northward, one after another, there are 3 mountains named Nila, Shveta, and Shringavan. These mark the borders of the 3 varshas named Ramyaka, Hiranmaya, and Kuru, and separate them from one another. The width of these mountains is 2,000 yojanas, 16,000 miles. Lengthwise, they extend east and west to the beaches of the ocean of salt water. Going from south to north, the length of each mountain is 1/10 of that of the previous mountain, but the height of them all is the same. Purport. In this regard, Madhvacharya quotes the following verses from the Brahmanda Purana. Yata Bhagavate Tuktam Bhavananam Kosha Lakshanam Tasya viro dato yojam anya gran tan tarestitam. Mando de puranam chaiva vyatyasam shirasangare rahu soma ravinam cha mandalad dvi gunoktiktam. Vinaiva sarvam uneriam yojana bedito tratu. It appears from these verses that aside from the sun and moon, there is an invisible planet called Rahu. The movements of Rahu cause both solar and lunar eclipses. We suggest that the modern expeditions attempting to reach the moon are mistakenly going to Rahu. Text 9. Similarly, south of Ilavatravarsh and extending from east to west are three great mountains named from north to south, Nishada, Himakuta, and Himalaya. Each of them is 10,000 yojanas, 800,000 miles high. They mark the boundaries of the three varshas named Harivarsha, Kimpurusha Varsha, and Bharatvarsha, India. Text 10. In the same way, east and west of Ilavritavarsh are two great mountains named Malyavan and Gandhamadan, respectively. These two mountains, which are 22,000 yojanas, 16,000 miles high, extend as far as Nila Mountain in the north and Nishada in the south. They indicate the borders of Ilavritavarsha and also the Varshas known as Ketumala and Bhadrashva. Purport. There are so many mountains even on this planet Earth, we do not think that the measurement of all of them have actually been calculated. While passing over the mountainous region from Mexico to Caracas, we actually saw so many mountains that we doubt whether their height, length, and breadth have been properly measured. Therefore, as indicated in Srimad Bhagavatam by Shukadeva Goswami, we should not try to comprehend the greater mountain areas of the universe merely by our calculations. Shukadeva Goswami has already stated that such calculations would be very difficult even if one had a duration of life like that of Brahma. We should simply be satisfied with the statements of authorities like Shukadeva Goswami and appreciate how the entire cosmic manifestation has been made possible by the external energy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The measurements given herein, such as 10,000 yojanas and 100,000 yojanas, should be considered correct because they have been given by Shukadeva Goswami. Our experimental knowledge can neither verify nor disprove the statements of Srimad Bhagavatam. We should simply hear these statements from authorities. If we can appreciate the extensive energy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, that will benefit us. Text 11. On the four sides of the great mountain known as Sumeru are four mountains, Mandara, Mehu Mandara, Saparshva, and Kamuda, which are like its belts. The length and height of these mountains is calculated to be 10,000 yojanas, 80,000 miles. Text 12. Standing like flagstaffs on the summits of these four mountains are a mango tree, a rose apple tree, a kadamba tree, and a banyan tree. These trees are calculated to have a width of 100 yojanas, 800 miles, and a height of 1,100 yojanas, 8,800 miles. Their branches also spread to a radius of 1,100 yojanas. O Maharaj Prickett, O best of the Bharat dynasty, between these four mountains are four huge lakes. The water of the first tastes just like milk, the water of the second like honey, and that of the third like sugar cane juice. The fourth lake is filled with pure water. The celestial beings known as the Siddhas, Charnas, and Gandharvas, who are known as demigods, enjoy the facilities of those four lakes. Consequently, they have the natural perfections of mystic yoga, such as the power to become smaller than the smallest or greater than the greatest. There are also four celestial gardens named Nandana, Chaitarath, Vaibhrajaka, and Sarvatobhadra. Text 15. The best of the demigods, along with their wives, who are like ornaments of heavenly beauty, meet together and enjoy within those gardens while their glories are sung by lesser demigods known as Gandharvas. Text 16. On the slopes of Mandara Mountain is a mango tree named Devakuta. It is 1,100 yojanas high. Mangoes as big as mountain peaks and as sweet as nectar fall from the top of this tree for the enjoyment of the denizens of heaven. Purport. In the Vayu Purana, there is also a reference of this tree by great learned sages. Aratininam satani ashtav eka shasti adhikanicha fala pramanam akhyatam rishibis tatva darshibi. Text 17. When all those solid fruits fall from such a height, they break, and the sweet, fragrant juice from them flows out and becomes increasingly more fragrant as it mixes with other scents. That juice cascades from the mountain in waterfalls and becomes a river called Arunoda, which flows pleasantly through the eastern side of Ilavrita. Text 18. The pious wives of the Yakshas act as personal maidservants to assist Bhavani, the wife of Lord Shiva. Because they drink water from the river of Arunoda, their bodies become fragrant, and as the air carries that fragrance, it perfumes the entire atmosphere for 80 miles around. Text 19. Similarly, the fruits of the jambu tree, which are full of pulp and have very small seeds, fall from a great height and break to pieces. Those fruits are the size of elephants, and the juice gliding from them becomes a river named Jambunadi. This river falls a distance of 10,000 yojanas from the summit of Merumandala to the southern side of Ilavrita and floods the entire land of Ilavrita with juice. Purport. We can only imagine how much juice there might be in a fruit that is the size of an elephant but has a very tiny seed. Naturally, the juice from the broken jambu fruits forms waterfalls and floods the entire land of Ilavrita. That juice produces an immense quantity of gold, as will be explained in the next verses. Text 20 and 21. The mud on both banks of the river Jambunadi, being moistened by the flowing juice and then dried by the air and the sunshine, produces huge quantities of gold called Jambunada. The denizens of heaven use this gold for various kinds of ornaments. Therefore, all the inhabitants of the heavenly planets and their youthful wives are fully decorated with golden helmets, bangles, and belts, and thus they enjoy life. Purport. By the arrangement of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the rivers on some planets produce gold on their banks. The poor inhabitants of this earth, because of their incomplete knowledge, are captivated by a so-called Bhagavan who can produce a small quantity of gold. However, it is understood that in a higher planetary system in this material world, the mud on the banks of the Jambunadi mixes with jambu juice, reacts with the sunshine in the air, and automatically produces huge quantities of gold. Thus, the men and women are decorated there by various golden ornaments, and they look very nice. Unfortunately, on Earth, there is such a scarcity of gold that the governments of the world keep it in a reserve and issue paper currency. Because that currency is not backed up by gold, the paper they distribute as money is worthless. But nevertheless, the people on Earth are very proud of materialistic advancement. In modern times, girls and ladies have ornaments made of plastic instead of gold, and plastic utensils are used instead of golden ones, yet people are very proud of their material wealth. Therefore, the people of this age are described as Manda Sumanda Matayo Manda Bhagya Hyupadrata, Srimad Bhagavatam 1.1.10. In other words, they are extremely bad and slow to understand the opulence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They have been described as Sumanda Matayo because of their conception. Their conceptions are so crippled that they accept a bluffer who produces a little gold to be God. Because they have no gold in their possession, they are actually poverty-stricken, and therefore they are considered unfortunate. Sometimes these unfortunate people want to be promoted to the heavenly planets to achieve fortunate positions, as described in this verse, but pure devotees of the Lord are not at all interested in such opulence. Indeed, devotees sometimes compare the color of gold to that of bright golden stool. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has instructed devotees not to be allured by golden ornaments and beautifully decorated women. Nadanam najanam nasundarim a devotee should not be allured by gold, beautiful women, or the prestige of having many followers. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu therefore confidentially prayed, Manma janmani janmani shre bhavatad bhakti rahoi tikitoi. Quote, my Lord, please bless me with your devotional service. I do not want anything else. End quote. A devotee may pray to be delivered from this material world. That is his only aspiration. Ai nandakun tanuji kinkaram patinambam vishame babambdo kipya tavapada pankaja stitadulishadisham vishintiya. A humble devotee simply prays to the Lord, quote, kindly pick me up from the material world, which is full of varieties of material opulence, and keep me under the shelter of your lotus feet, end quote. Srila Narottam Das Thakur prays, Haha Prabhu Nanda Suta Vishabhanu Sutiyuta Karuna Karaha E Bara Narottama Dasa Kaya Ta Tahila Rangapaya Toma Vina Ke Ache Amara. Quote, O my Lord, O son of Nanda Maharaj, now you are standing before me with your consort, the daughter of Vishabhanu, Shrimati Radharani. Kindly accept me as the dust of your lotus feet. Please do not kick me away, for I have no other shelter. End quote. Similarly, Prabodhananda Sarasvati indicates that the position of the demigods, who are decorated with golden helmets and other ornaments, is no better than a phantasmagoria. Tridasapur akasha pushpayate. A devotee is never allured by such opulences. He simply aspires to become the dust at the lotus feet of the Lord. Text 22. On the side of Suparshva Mountain, it stands a big tree called Mahakadamba, which is very celebrated. From the hollows of this tree flow five rivers of honey, each about five vyamas wide. This flowing honey falls incessantly from the top of Suparshva Mountain and flows all around Ilavritavarsh, beginning from the western side. Thus, the whole land is saturated with the pleasing fragrance. Purport. The distance between one hand and another when one spreads both his arms is called a vyama. It comes to about 8 feet. Thus, each of the rivers was about 40 feet wide, making a total of about 200 feet. Text 23. The air carrying the scent from the mouths of those who drink that honey perfumes the land for 100 yojanas around. Text 24. Similarly, on Kamuda Mountain, there is a great banyan tree, which is called Satavalsha, because it has 100 main branches. From those branches come many roots, from which many rivers are flowing. These rivers flow down from the top of the mountain to the northern side of Ilavritavarsh for the benefit of those who live there. Because of these flowing rivers, all the people have ample supplies of milk, yogurt, honey, clarified butter, ghee, molasses, food grains, clothes, bedding, sitting places, and ornaments. All the objects they desire are sufficiently supplied for their prosperity, and therefore they are very happy. Purport. The prosperity of humanity does not depend on demoniac civilization that has no culture and no knowledge, but only gigantic skyscrapers and huge automobiles always rushing down the highways. The products of nature are sufficient. When there is a profuse supply of milk, yogurt, honey, food grains, ghee, molasses, dhotis, saris, bedding, sitting places, and ornaments, the residents are actually opulent. When a profuse supply of water from the river inundates the land, all these things can be produced, and there will be no scarcity. All this depends, however, on the performance of sacrifices described in the Vedic literature. Anad bhavanti bhutani parjanyad anasambhava yajnad bhavati parjanyo yagnad karmana samudbhava. Quote, all living beings subsist on food grains which are produced from rains. Rains are produced by performance of jaga sacrifice, and jaga is born of prescribed duties. End quote. These are the prescriptions given in Bhagavad Gita 3.14. If people follow these principles in full Krishna consciousness, human society will be prosperous and they will be happy both in this life and in the next. Text 25. The residents of the material world who enjoy the products of these flowing rivers have no wrinkles on their body and no gray hair. They never feel fatigue, and perspiration does not give their bodies bad odor. They are not afflicted by old age, disease, or untimely death, nor do they suffer from chilly cold or scorching heat, nor do their bodies lose their luster. They all live very happily, without anxieties, until death. Purport. This verse hints at the perfection of human society even within this material world. The miserable conditions of this material world can be corrected by a sufficient supply of milk, yogurt, honey, ghee, molasses, food grains, ornaments, bedding, sitting places, and so on. This is human civilization. Ample food grains can be produced through agricultural enterprises, and profuse supplies of milk, yogurt, and ghee can be arranged through cow protection. Abundant honey can be obtained if the forests are protected. Unfortunately, in modern civilization, men are busy killing the cows that are the source of yogurt, milk, and ghee. They are cutting down all of the trees that supply honey and are opening factories to manufacture nuts, bolts, automobiles, and wine instead of engaging in agriculture. How can the people be happy? They must suffer from all the misery of materialism. Their bodies become wrinkled and gradually deteriorate until they become almost like dwarves, and a bad odor emanates from their body because of unclean perspiration resulting from eating all kinds of nasty things. This is not human civilization. If people actually want happiness in this life and want to prepare for the best in the next life, they must adopt a Vedic civilization. In a Vedic civilization, there is a full supply of all the necessities mentioned above. Text 26. There are other mountains beautifully arranged around the foot of Mount Meru, like the filaments around the whorl of a lotus flower. Their names are Karanga, Kurara, Kashumba, Vaikanka, Trikuta, Shishira, Patanga, Ruchaka, Nishada, Sinisva, Sava, Kapila, Shanka, Vaidhurya, Jarudi, Hansa, Rishaba, Naga, Kalanjara, and Narada. Text 27. On the eastern side of Sumeru Mountain are two mountains named Jathara and Devakuta, which extend to the north and south for 18,000 yojanas, 144,000 miles. Similarly, on the western side of Sumeru are two mountains named Pavana and Pariyatra, which also extend north and south for the same distance. On the southern side of Sumeru are two mountains named Kailash and Karavira, which extend east and west for 18,000 yojanas, and on the northern side of Sumeru, extending for the same distance east and west, are two mountains named Trishringa and Makara. The width and height of these mountains is 2,000 yojanas, 16,000 miles. Sumeru, a mountain of gold, solid gold, shining as brilliantly as fire, is surrounded by these eight mountains. Text 28. In the middle of the summit of Meru is the town of Lord Brahma. On each of its four sides is calculated to extend for 10 million yojanas, 80 million miles. It is made entirely of gold, and therefore learned scholars and sages call it Satakombi. Text 29. Surrounding Brahmapuri in all directions are the residents of the eight principal governors of the planetary systems, beginning with King Indra. These abodes are similar to Brahmapuri, but are one-fourth in size. Purport. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur confirms that the townships of Lord Brahma and the eight subordinate governors of the planetary systems, beginning with Indra, are mentioned in other Puranas. Mero Nava Purani Shir Manovati Amaravati Tejovati Samayamani Tata Krishna Gana Para Shradavati Gandhavati Tata Chanya Mahodaya Yashovati Chabaramendra Bayadinam Yatakramam. Brahma's township is known as Manovati, and those of his assistants, such as Indra and Agni, are known as Amaravati, Tejavati, Samyayani, Krishna Gana, Shadavati, Gandhavati, Mahodaya, and Yashovati. Brahmapuri is situated in the middle, and the other eight puris surround it in all directions. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports of the fifth canto, 16th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled A Description of Jambudvipa.